Hello, everyone. Welcome to yet another edition of Interviewing the Legends. I'm your host, Ray Shasho. David Minasian can be described as a Renaissance man of sorts with experience and interests in a number of fields, including film, music, and literature. David began classical piano training at the age of 5, and by the age of 11, he was making films. After graduating with honors with a degree in television and film, David began working freelance for various production companies in and around LA as a producer, director, writer, editor, cinematographer, and composer while simultaneously recording albums of his own music. David has directed music and concert videos for the artists such as Three Dog Night, Camel, and a PBS television special for legendary singer, guitarist, composer Justin Hayward of the Moody Blues. I Won't Be Led Astray is the second single off the latest studio album from The New World by the legendary producer, composer, musician, and engineer Alan Parsons. The track was written by David Minasian and Alan, along with Kim Bullard of the Elton John Band. Features Parsons alumni David Pack, of course, of Ambrosia fame, and on lead vocals, together with blues icon Joe Bonamassa on lead guitar. The music video stars Sophia Olson, daughter of Alan Parsons lead singer PJ Olson, and was directed and produced by Trinity Houston and David Minasian for IM3 Global Entertainment and Frontiers Records. Reactions to the emotive song and video so far have been overwhelming. Please welcome American film producer, screenwriter, director, musician, singer, and record producer, David Minasian, to Interviewing the Legends. Hello, David.
Hello, Ray. Fantastic to talk to you.
You are a Renaissance guy, aren't you?
I wish half the stuff you just said was true, but yeah.
Well, it says so on the internet. That's all that matters. I interviewed Alan not long ago, and right. He was nice enough to put me on his website on the front page because I love the album and I did like the song you guys wrote together. It's the second single off the latest album from The New World. Right. How did you guys get together on that project?
Well, we had been, my partner and I, Trinity Houston, and I had been working with Alan for quite a while. We had filmed a number of his concerts during 2019. We filmed this concert called Live in the Netherlands, mm-hmm. which was fantastic because we ended up using like 22 cameras at this place.
Wow.
And it which is pretty overwhelming for a concert, but it turned out really well. And then we shot another video in 2019 with him live in Tel Aviv. Mm-hmm. So just the opportunity to be able to go to Europe and travel with the band and then go to Israel, it's just very surreal, because I was a fan of Alan Parsons back when I was a kid. And so it's just been an amazing ride to work with all these legendary musicians that I admired when I was a kid. And so from there, it just kind of, he knew that I was a songwriter as well as a filmmaker. And I submitted that song to him in kind of an unfinished form, and he really liked it. And mm-hmm. And I had worked on it with Kim Bullard from the Elton John Band. And we submitted it to him, and he got involved in the writing process and then produced it. And we ended up producing and directing the music video as well.
Yeah, I love Alan, man, and he goes way back. And of course, he was the engineer on the Dark Side of the Moon, Pink Floyd, and I think he did tell me that he would, when the Beatles were on the roof, I think he was on the roof as well, watching the Beatles when they performed. So
he was in the new the Get Back movie, the series that came out on Disney Plus. He was actually in it quite a bit. You can see him as this young 19-year-old kid, engineering the Beatles as one of his first jobs. That's pretty amazing.
That's very amazing. Yeah. Me and you have something in common where I'm interviewing all my heroes and you're actually performing with all your heroes.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny how things like that work out, isn't it?
It's surreal. It's amazing. It's like, you know, I have to pinch myself, make sure I'm awake.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I mean, and I had been an Ambrosia fan as well. I mm-hmm. bought the first couple of Ambrosia albums when I was a kid. And here I am filming David Pack, you know, singing one of my songs. It's just, yeah.
It's incredible. It really is. Yeah.
Very lucky.
We have the same taste in music, I think. You know, I mean, we're both lovers of prog rock, of course. Yeah. And I saw a picture of you at Capitol Records, which was really neat, you know, and you're pointing up at Frank Sinatra.
Right.
And I love Sinatra. I saw him 5 times in concert. So I'm in Vegas, Atlantic City, got to sit on the front row because I paid a lot of money. Really wasn't a lot of money back then. But I really admire, I'm kind of jealous, as a matter of fact, of you, your relationship with Camel, because I've always loved Camel. And there's a mystique surrounding Camel. There always has been, kind of like before Pink Floyd got a little bit more commercial, you know. Mm-hmm. They perform a lot in Europe. You don't see them coming to America anymore. And of course, Andy's had some health issues, but you've had a long-standing relationship with Camel, and that I really admire that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that was another thing that was very amazing. I had gotten in touch with them back in the mid '90s.
Mm-hmm.
They'd been away for a while, mm-hmm. and then they got back together and did this album called The Dust and Dreams, and they went on tour with it. And they had some guy shot a amateur video of one of the shows during that 1992 tour. And Camel was kind of looking around at a way to try to salvage this amateur footage. And I got to thinking, you know, why is a band of Camel's caliber trying to salvage amateur footage, you know? And so I offered, I said, hey, you know, let's do something new. So, we ended up doing the coming of age video and the curriculum vitae documentary film. So those were the first two projects I did with Camel, and I ended up doing 9 more, you know, a total of 9 DVDs. And then Andy offered to play on the album that I sort of was a comeback album for me, which was just mind boggling. He did this absolutely magical guitar solo on the song Masquerade that was on the album Random Acts of Beauty. So that was another amazing.
Yeah, they're an incredible band. You know, you don't hear much about them, but they're still played over and over again on like prog stations, you know. And of course, you know, Mirage, I mean, that's a classic. And Lady Fantasy, of course, everybody loves that song.
Yeah. And, you know, what was amazing about Andy is that, you know, we all know a lot of these prog bands that we were fans of in the early days, and some of their later material doesn't quite measure up to their older stuff. But the stuff that he was doing lately, you know, like Harvard Tears and Rajas and Not in a Wink, were just as good as some of the earlier albums. So this guy had been around for so long and still was able to keep that level of magic and quality going. And so I really admire him. Yeah,
and they've gone through a lot of lineup changes, and still they sound as good as ever. You know, I wish they would come to the U.S. You know, when Andy is better, but I don't know. I don't know why they don't. I don't, because they've got a lot of followers here in the U.S. You know, a lot of diehards.
For a while they were actually living in Northern California.
Oh, really?
And so when they did tour, they actually would do a couple of shows in California before going to some of the other, going on to Europe.
Right.
So I was able to film a couple of shows in, you know, one in Los Angeles, one in the up towards Monterey, and those all came out as DVDs. But that was, you're right. I wish they would tour here.
Yeah. Another band that has nothing to do with the U.S. anymore, and I'm not sure if they're still a band, but Status Quo, you know, Status Quo never comes to the U.S. and they're a great band as well. So that's what I try to do, especially with prog bands. I try to get a lot of bands from all over the world and, you know, spotlight them on my show. So people in the U.S. will, because there's some great prog stuff out there now.
Oh, there's some amazing stuff. Yeah. I was more than, you know, I tried to get a record deal. I was working in the film industry, so I had a regular job. So I was doing great. But I was wanted to simultaneously put out some music because I had this classical background and I love progressive rock. But my timing was really off. You know, in the 1980s, you couldn't get arrested if you were trying to shop progressive rock music to these record labels. And you had to get a record deal in those days to get your stuff out there. All the A&R departments said, no, you can't do that.
I know.
Which didn't make sense to me because bands like Yes and, you know, Genesis were filling up, you know, Yes were doing stadiums. Genesis filled up the Los Angeles Forum, which is an 18,000 seat place before even having a hit single.
Yeah.
You know, so progressive rock was a big force in music. ELP was headlining these festivals. And for record companies to just suddenly say, you know what, we're not going to do that kind of music anymore. Just shut off this whole huge audience.
Yeah.
And if you lived through the 80s, you were very frustrated.
Yep.
Trying to find these progressive music because they were making the prog bands like Camel. And Genesis, they were forcing them to do singles, you know,
right?
And they were forcing them to change their style, and it was, you know, Renaissance, but there was another one. It was just ridiculous. But then it finally started coming back in the 90s, which was great.
Yeah, I was a top 40 disc jockey back in the late 70s and early 80s. So you know, and it was a very eclectic mix of music. You know, you had new wave. You had disco, you know, Donna Summer was huge. I was very upset when Donna passed away. And I know Donna's husband, we talk from time to time. He's a great guy. But yeah, it was very eclectic, you know, and Zeppelin did have a top 40 hit back then. And of course the Cars were popular and, but it was eclectic. Yeah. An eclectic period. So I can understand why prog did have a hard time. Could you imagine Frank Zappa? I mean, he had a difficult time getting his music out.
Right. Yes.
And unfortunately, he hit it with What Valley Girl, right?
Right.
Which was not his best stuff at all.
Right. Yeah, it's all about timing, I guess, you know.
Yeah. Exactly. You got your degree from California State University, and I guess you took filmmaking as well. But what was your first gig as a, you know, as a movie guy, a filmmaker with a legendary rock band? How did you first get your start doing that?
I had been doing documentaries and working on a few feature films, I was doing different stuff, all different kinds of stuff. One of the things I love about filmmaking, it's got so many different aspects to it.
Right.
You got producing, writing, directing, editing, camera work, lighting, acting, scoring, all of it's fascinating. So I was doing a lot of different things, and the first musical gig that I did was with Three Dog Night. They were being managed by Jerry Weintraub's management Three,
big guy.
So they had just done a set of new recordings,
right?
And it was one of my earliest directing jobs, and we did this music video for a song called "Shot in the Dark," you know, not much happened with it, but they were great guys, and they were wonderful guys to work with. So that led to a few other things, a few scoring jobs. And then I think my first big concert film was with Camel, the Coming of Age video. And then that led to a whole series of stuff with Camel, which then led to Justin Hayward, which then led to Alan Parsons.
Yeah, you know, very cool.
It's just kind of snowballed, yeah.
You know, you should be very much in demand, especially because you can, you do music videos as well. Can you do a music video? Yeah. I guess you can.
Yeah, we've done a whole bunch of those. We did.
Yeah.
We've done five or six for Alan Parsons, the neighborhood right. show. I've done a few with Justin Hayward. In fact, I have a new one with Justin Hayward that's coming out. Ooh, I don't know if I should announce that. But anyway, I just finished it. That's coming out here pretty quick.
Okay.
And I did another one called The Wind of Heaven with Justin Hayward, which is a song that I co-wrote also. But yeah, I've done a lot of music videos. And there, I think the reason like someone like Justin Hayward likes working with me is because he says, you know, that I get his music. So I've got the camera on the right spot at the right time. And, you know, because I have a musical background, I think I can film these concerts and music videos and give it a little bit of an extra.
Oh, sure.
Add a little bit extra to it.
You know, it's funny. There's a lot of amateurs on YouTube that put their touch, their kind of a movie behind their favorite music. And some of them are pretty good. You know, but there are a lot of up and coming bands, good bands that put music videos out and they're very shabby. You know, I'm surprised that they, you know, don't get somebody like you to do it, you know, unless you're way overpriced. I don't know. I have no idea.
No, I wish it was overpriced. No, no, I love doing it. I actually kind of am lucky enough to be able to choose the projects that I do. Mm-hmm. Especially if I'm going to be doing a concert film, I want it to be a band or a style of music that I like.
Right.
Because I'm going to be hearing those songs over and over and over again during the post-production process.
Yeah.
So if I'm working on a project with music that I don't really like, then I'm going to rush through it. I know I'm, you know, whereas if I love the music, then I'm going to make sure I get it perfect.
Sure.
So I might as well pick the bands that I like.
Yeah. There's a couple of guys I could refer you. I don't know if, do you know Ben Craven in Australia?
Yeah.
He's awesome, yeah. You know, and I love his music, you know,
yeah.
I really do. And he could use a guy like you probably on his next album or on the existing album. Yeah.
Yeah. I'd love to do stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, there's probably a good handful of guys I could probably refer you to that, you know, they're music videos are not that good, or maybe they don't even have one, you know, that kind of thing. I think it's important too to have a good music video. I do miss the MTV era. I loved them when they first came out.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
It was pretty cool. It's a shame that thing that went away because they could have promoted a lot more great music nowadays, you know?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's, I think that's, you know, when you come out with an album, you've got to have a music video.
Especially today.
A couple of them.
Exactly. Here's something I admire, and I admire your parents for doing this, because you started piano lessons at 5 years old.
Yes.
And to stay focused as a kid, I give a lot of credit to your parents. I've got five grandkids, so I know.
Yeah.
And my daughter took piano. She's a really good singer. They're both black belts in karate, and they almost quit at the end, and I had to push them to do that.
Yeah.
How did your mom, you know, and dad keep you focused when you were young like that?
Well, it was a little weird. I actually pestered my parents when I was 5 years old to take piano lessons.
Really?
I don't know why. I have no idea. I wasn't from a musical family at all.
Wow.
My dad was a naval captain. And I just begged them, and so they relented, and then I just kind of stuck with it, and I got really good at classical piano, you know, playing Beethoven, Bach, Chopin, all that stuff. So that by the time I was 15, I was asked by my instructor to become professional classical concert pianist, and I would have, we talked about that, and I found out I would have had to practice 4 hours a day. Which prior to that time, I'd only been practicing an hour a day. And I didn't love classical music that much to give up hanging out with my friends and playing baseball and stuff. So I didn't do it, you know. So I quit, and my piano teacher was furious. She'd invested 10 years into me and thought I was going to be this extravagant classical pianist. But I think that everything worked out great, you know, because I was making little movies at the time too with my little Super 8 camera.
Really? Super and 8. I remember those days.
Yeah, that dates me, but it was I love that just as much. So
how many years did you actually, you know, study piano, would you say?
Well, 10 years from 10 the age years. Of 5 to the age of 15.
Yeah.
I studied. And then I kind of concentrated on films for a little while. Then I got back into music. It was actually the Moody Blues album, mm-hmm. Seventh Sojourn, that I heard that inspired me. I heard one song off of that album that had been written by Justin Hayward. And I had never heard anything like that because I wasn't really familiar with it. So I wasn't familiar with prog or anything.
Right.
And that one song just sounded magical to me. And that got me reinterested in music. And I started exploring all these prog bands. And then I just decided that inspired me to write songs. So, and it was very easy for me to do because I already had this musical background behind me.
Yeah.
But then I found out, I started recording demos and shopping them around, and nobody wanted them. So, because I was too late to the, I was a little bit too late to the game. But, so I kind of fooled around with it a little bit, and I wrote a theme for a movie, and you know, did a couple little things.
Mm-hmm.
I did an album back in the mid '80s that didn't do anything, and, but I'd always kind of had it in the background.
And, what was the movie that you did a theme for?
It was a movie with Chris Christopherson in it and Mark Landa called The
Joyride.
You
did
the
theme for that, huh? That's great.
Yeah. And so it was just, you know, I always had music kind of percolating in the back.
Sure.
And it was actually Andy Latimer that finally inspired me to just go for it. He knew I had a musical background. We'd mm-hmm. been doing all these videos together. He said, "Dave, just record an album. Just do it. Just do it." And so I did, and I recorded the first track from that, and it was a song called "Masquerade."
Mm-hmm.
And I sent it to him, and he offered to play on it. I was like, "What?"
Exactly.
You know. And he sent me back this incredible, magical guitar solo, and I just. And at that point, that kind of changed everything because I knew now I had to complete the album and get it out there because this was an amazing thing that had happened. And that became the Random Acts of Beauty album. My son and I recorded the rest of the album together.
And how cool how cool was it to play with your son, huh?
Oh, he was amazing. He was 20 years old.
He's a great guitar player, man.
He was an amazing guitar player, And I kind of put him on the spot because we ended up finishing this album, and I put mm-hmm. the song from Andy Latimer as the mm-hmm. first track.
Right.
And then the other six tracks had my son playing lead guitar. And so I'd set the bar really high with Andy Latimer on the first track. And here my 20-year-old son has to come up behind that and keep the level of the music at the same, you know, same level. But he did it, and it was I was just blown away. Between Andy Latimer and my son Justin, it made that first album just magical, and then that album just took off.
I want to mention Random Dreams, the very best of David Minasian. You wrote most of these songs, right, as well?
Yeah, I wrote all of them.
That's incredible.
I co-wrote one song with Justin Hayward, and then the other song I co-wrote with Annie Haslam from Renaissance and Steve Hackett from Genesis, which was the first time Annie and Steve had appeared together on a track. And that was actually the title track from my follow-up album, which was mm-hmm. The Sound of Dreams. And again, here's this process of co-writing songs with Annie Haslam, this legendary vocalist from Renaissance, who I admired since I was a kid, and then Steve Hackett, you know, the world's best, mm-hmm. the world's best guitar players, you know, from Genesis, and I don't know what's wrong with these people. I don't know why they're Why do you want to work with me?
I love Steve. I have Steve on many times, and he's a great guy. He really is. He even talked to me between shows, and he says, and we did a Zoom interview. He says, you know, don't worry about my appearance. I know his hair was all messed up and he looked really tired, you know, from touring and stuff. I said, don't worry about it, man. That's what you do. You know. But you mentioned Masquerade. Andy right. Latimer is on that on guitar. Right. It does sound a little bit like Camel too.
Yeah, it does.
You can't help sounding like Camel, you know. Right. But you got some of my favorite tunes on that. Is you know, like Storming the Castle. Awesome, yeah. Awesome keyboards. I love to get keyboards and guitar combination. You know, it's incredible.
And that particular song was inspired by Rick Wakeman.
Really?
There was an album that he did called, was it Out There? Something like that.
Right.
Which was a kind of a heavier album for him. Mm-hmm. And a couple of the songs, what they would do is he'd do a Moog solo, followed by a guitar solo, back to a Moog solo, back to a guitar solo. So that's what I ended up doing with my son on that. We just kind of traded solos and, you know, made that the second half of that song really punchy. I love that track.
Justin, man, he must have been playing guitar for quite a while, because he is an excellent guitar player, and he shines on a lot of these tracks like Summer's End.
Oh yeah, you know? beautiful guitar solo.
Yeah, he's incredible. Tell him I said that, by the way, because
okay, you know,
my son plays drums, and he's just natural at it, you know. You know, sometimes I think you can't learn the drums. You got to kind of have a natural ability to play drums, because it's not that easy to play drums. You can't just, like I said, Summer's End, the Wind of Heaven, Justin Hayward, on that one. It's a beautiful song, beautiful, beautiful song.
I mean, that one was just, that was amazing. That was probably because it was originally Justin Hayward that inspired me to even try songwriting as a kid, and to be able to collaborate with him, and for having to do that kind of to take that song in the way that he recorded it was just incredible. Yeah, that's kind of a weird song for him. If you're familiar with his discography, to have, you know, it's a beautiful song, but then it's got this really fast organ solo in it, you know, and it's totally unlike anything, you know. I'm kind of surprised that he decided to let me keep that in there, because it was kind of an unusual thing for him to do, but I think that's one of his best songs.
Yeah, I do too. It's a fantastic tune, man. It's great. I've interviewed all the Moody Blues except for Justin. He's the only one I can't get a hold of.
Okay.
I did Ray Thomas, you know, and right. What's
John
the matter?
Lodge. John Lodge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the keyboard player. Oh my goodness. Not Michael Pender.
Patrick Mraz. Yeah.
Patrick Mraz. Oh my goodness. That's what happens when you get older. Love Patrick. I've had Patrick on the show several times. He's a good guy too.
Yeah.
And he's good friends with Annie.
Right.
Rooms, no, The Sound of Dreams has Annie, Steve Hackett, like you mentioned. Is Billy Sherwood on that tune as well?
Yeah, or, he is. He's doing that amazing bass part through that 10-minute song, yeah.
Yeah, he's been around Chris Squire a long time, that's why.
Yeah.
He's picked up a lot of Chris's. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, again, to be able to, I mean, Billy actually lives in Southern California, so we hit it off really well. And he's just a great guy. I saw him on Cruise to the Edge last time, and he's just a great. He does a lot of stuff, but his bass playing is just off the charts with Yes Now, and a lot of his solo stuff.
Here's a trivia question for you: do you know who Billy's godfather is?
Yes, Milton Berle.
Yeah, very good. And everybody knows that. That's pretty cool. It's funny how everybody's kind of connected, isn't it? you know, and music
It
and
is.
showbiz. I've interviewed so many people. He says, yeah, well, my cousin is so-and-so. And, you know, it's amazing. Everybody's kind of connected in a way. Guess it runs in the blood or something.
Yeah.
You know? Now you're going to tell me your great uncle was Clark Gable, right?
Well, I'm not that I know of.
You know a word that's been coming up a lot lately in prog rock? Cinematic. They never added that word to prog, but now it's coming out and it fits it, doesn't it? Cinematic.
It does. In fact, when I kind of do interviews, I always, that's the one thing they always say, because they know I have a film background.
Mm-hmm.
They just assume, oh, well, your stuff is very cinematic sound.
Right.
I don't mean it to be, but I guess it does kind of end up having this sort of epic,
it does,
you know, sound to it.
That's the other word, epic. And you know, Kansas, a lot of their songs are epic tunes. You know, you can almost see that in a movie or a, you know, that kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah. Room with Dark Corners, that's another great tune. Talk about that song real quick. What were you envisioning with that song when you wrote that?
Gosh, I don't. I think I mentioned I'd done this song for this movie, The Joyriders.
Right, right.
And at the time, so when that song kind of hit, I was being asked to submit a bunch of songs to these different publishers. So I sat down and I wrote a whole slew of very commercial songs, which is mm-hmm. something I'd never done before. And one of them was Blue Rain, which we recorded on the Random Acts album. And then there was this one, Room with Dark Corners, which was supposed to be on Random Acts, but it just didn't sound very good with me singing it. So I saved it for the next album, The Sound of Dreams. And then I got Julie Reagans, who mm-hmm. has been with the Moody Blues for many years and now is touring with Justin Hayward on his solo shows. And she's this awesome singer. And I just felt it fit perfectly. I was trying to write a song kind of, I think, from a female mm-hmm. perspective.
Right.
Because I knew on the demo, the original demo, I had a female singer that was going to do it. And it was just kind of I wanted to do something that was a little bit more rocky mm-hmm. with the power chords and just kind of do a lyric that was kind of someone that just stays in their room and fantasizes all day.
Right.
What the song's about. And you know, you just lie in bed and you just don't mm-hmm. care what's going on in the outside world. You're just enjoying your own thoughts and daydreams and stuff. So that's kind of what that song's about.
You mentioned Julie. Julie's been around. Yeah, besides Justin Hayward, the Moody Blues, Queen Latifah, Sergio Mendes, the Beach Boys, the Glenn Miller Orchestra, Neil Sedaka, Brian Seltzer. And George O'Keefe. Is it Jeff O'Keefe from Pentagram?
Jeff O'Keefe,
and I'm originally from the D.C. area, and I think Jeff is from the D.C. area as well.
Right.
Yeah, so I remember Pentagram.
He was a DJ for a while.
Mm-hmm.
He was trying to track me down because he knew that I had worked with Justin Hayward. And so we met kind of over the internet. And then he was shocked to learn that I knew who Pentagram was. He was the drummer for that band, the original incarnation of that band, which never really got going. You know, they were, they've got a weird history. There was a documentary that I had watched on Netflix, which told their whole history, which is fascinating, how the whole thing kind of just fell apart. But Jeff was very instrumental in, he's the one who introduced me to Annie Haslam.
Really?
Yeah. Huh. So he's a great guy.
Yeah, DC's had quite a, you know, list of really good talent. You know, we had Roy Buchanan, famous guitar player, very famous in DC. I mean, Nils Lofgren was a big favorite around that, you know, especially in Baltimore. I was born in Baltimore, and Nils is from that area. Mm-hmm. I think he was from Silver Spring originally. I can't remember. Twin Flames at Twilight. What a great title for a song, man.
Yeah.
And that was like a bonus track or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, because, well, the whole purpose of Random Dreams,
right,
was for some of my stuff to come out on vinyl.
Right.
Some of the previous stuff I had done. And, of course, when you're writing songs that are like 10 minutes, you can't fit too many of them on vinyl.
Yeah, exactly.
So we were able to get six of them on the Random Dreams vinyl. And then we had this extra 13-minute song, which just wouldn't fit on it. So that's a bonus digital track, yeah.
Yeah, 13 minutes and 42 seconds. I heard a lot of things in that song. I heard kind of a medieval twist in the beginning, then kind of a progressive metal sound. Yeah. Who was singing? Was that you?
That was me singing. But
really?
It's mainly my son, Justin, writing a lot of that.
Oh, wow. And
it's, it was just, he came to me.
Uh-huh.
We were going to collaborate because on the previous album, we had collaborated on this 14-minute epic piece called Frozen in Time.
Right.
So we were really good at collaborating. But this time, he just kind of came in with the whole thing, you know, and I thought, well, I don't really need to do anything here. So, that was an amazing thing. I mean, Justin's an amazing musician. He's just a great songwriter and a great guitar player.
Well, what's so cool is that he likes your music as well. You know,
that is,
you guys
I know.
Mesh well together.
And he gets me. So he actually knows when we're in the studio together. I don't even have to say anything. He already knows what to play. You know what I like, and then he's got his own style. His style is a little bit more broad than mine. I'm kind of stuck on progressive rock, but he can do speed metal. He can do jazz. He can do anything. And he brings some of those elements into some of his leads, especially. Mm-hmm. He'll be playing this very melodic lead, and then he'll just go into the speed metal riff and then come back to this melodic lead. And it's a wonderful, wonderful background.
It's an interesting.
And he's also self-taught.
What were you going to say? I'm sorry.
Oh, he's self-taught too.
Yeah.
It's amazing how good he is.
That blows me away. People that are self-taught, you know, and they can just pick up things, you know,
right.
and most of the great legendary guitar players are that way,
right.
You know, they can't even read music, you know, which is incredible.
Right.
Yeah. And then you got a guy like you that studied his ass off.
Yes.
And you look at these self-taught guys and you go, hey, wait a minute.
Hey, yeah, I know.
Unbelievable. You know, that's kind of a new genre now is, prog metal. Have you noticed that? There's a lot of progressive metal bands out there now, you know?
Sure.
And there's a lot of shredding, you know?
Right.
Some shredding I like, but some, it's just, to me, noise. You know, it depends on how they, you know, put it in. I'm like you. I like the traditional prog bands, you know, because they're, like you said, it's very classical orientated, you know, and you got these, you know, musical prodigies that are in the band. You know, these guys are so, you know, intricate. The music's so intricate, and I love that, you know?
Oh, yeah, and it's just to be able to integrate. That's the thing I love about progressive rock is you can do anything you want.
Right.
You know, you're not limited to 3.5 minutes, you know, verse, chorus stuff. You can do that if you want, but you can also do these 10-minute, 20-minute, you can do whatever you want.
Sure.
And if you want to bring in some metal stuff, that's great, or some classical, you know, acoustic guitar stuff, but you can do that. You can, it's just an amazing genre.
There's always been kind of a similarity between jazz fusion and prog as well, you know.
Yeah.
like when you hear the Billy Cobham, you know, like in Spectrum, you know. And with Tommy Bolin and those guys, it's almost crossing into kind of like prog as well, you know?
Right. Yeah. There was an early band called Focus.
Oh yeah.
That brought in some jazz fusion and classical.
Right.
And yeah. that was a very interesting mix as well.
Very interesting. See, that's what's missing in today's music. You know, me as a top 40 guy back in the day and growing up in the 60s with fantastic radio, it makes me mad because the people that own these radio stations now don't know anything about music. They don't care about music. When you hear a rock station, they play the same crap, the same familiar songs that are pounded in your head for years and years and years because they think it's a familiar song that people want to hear over and over again. And that's wrong. We're not idiots. We like to hear different, you know, we want to diversify, you know, we want to hear different things, man. And it makes me mad. Yeah. You know, I wish I had the money to open up a radio station because I'd blow everybody away.
I know you would. No, I would subscribe to that for sure.
Yeah, man. It's crazy. It just makes me mad. I'm just tired of the, I always mention her and I always pick on her, Taylor Swifts, the Katy Perry. I'm just tired of that kind of crap, you know, enough. Enough. Let's have some good musicians. Let's have some bands. There's no bands anymore. You know, music's supposed to get better, not worse.
Well, exactly. That was one of my things when I was a kid, because I, you know, here I'm this 5-year-old, 6-year-old kid playing these classical pieces, and then which were very complex. And then you turn on the radio and you got these 3-chord, 4-chord songs that were kind of bland. And I didn't get that. I'm thinking, wait, we're supposed to get better with time, you know?
Yeah.
And then I started looking around at things like architecture, and I saw the house we were living in, which matched all the other houses on the block. And I looked back at like castles in England, 200, 300 years ago, that were just magnificent. I go, we should be building stuff better than that stuff.
Exactly. Yeah. You're 100% right.
We've digressed, you know? Yeah. And at least progressive rock is a slight attempt to try to bring some of that.
Yeah.
Intricacy back. And I love melody too. I always make sure my stuff's really melodic based.
Yep.
You know, I don't want to stray from that.
Well, lyrical content being about life is so important. You can identify with, you know, I'm just tired of the, you know, baby broke up, you know, all that crap, you know. It's you know, like Neil Morris, you know, I love his lyrics.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of these guys are actually, you know, Christian guys, and that's why their lyrical content is so meaningful. Like Kansas, they're Christian guys too, you know.
Right.
A lot, they put a lot of their Christianity in their music, and it comes out great in the lyrical content. So yeah, I don't know. You got some kind of relationship with Golden Robot Records, is that true?
Yes, they reissued Random Acts of Beauty in 2020, and then they got The Sound of Dreams in the same year, 2020. So which was my latest album. And then they did Random Dreams the following year, which was just a combination of those two albums on vinyl.
Right.
And then I'm going to be having another one coming out on Golden Robots.
Oh, good. What's coming out? What do you got coming out?
An album. I got two. Or I'm going to be doing Random Dreams Volume 2.
All right.
Get some more stuff out on vinyl.
Right.
And these are all remixed versions of what was on the on the original two CDs. So even if you got Random Acts and Sound of Dreams, and you're into vinyl, then get Random Dreams because the mixes are a lot different.
Okay.
And so that'll be coming out, and then we'll have a new album after that.
Are you your own engineer as well on these albums?
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's easy. Yeah. I mean, stuff has just gotten to where you can do it yourself. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, very easily. And then now I don't mix my stuff because I'm not that. I don't consider myself an engineer at all.
Right.
But I can at least get the tracks down and then put them in the hands of somebody else to kind of put them together.
Yeah. Maybe Alan can do the mixing for you.
Well, yeah.
That would be cool. <We'll
see. laughs> Probably be a couple $100,000.
Yeah, he'll give you a deal. A lot of people don't know Golden Robot Records is Derek Schulman, is related to Derek Schulman. And,
yeah,
you know, Gentle Giant.
Yeah, I met him.
I mean, Yeah.
Gentle Giant lead singer. He was, he was at the first meeting that I had with Golden Robot.
So yeah.
It was me and Derek and Billy Sherwood was there. And
right.
Also Mark Alexander Herber, who's the main guy in Australia.
Very cool. Yeah. Can you envision yourself doing a tour of some kind with some other, you know, your son, I don't know, some other.
I would love to. It's just, you know, I have all these movie projects that kind of keep me busy, and I'd have to make a decision to just stop that, be able to do that.
Yeah.
I know I'm probably not promoting, but even touring is kind of a risk, though. I mean, that could be very expensive, and you can lose money. You know, I think Golden Robot maybe not be as happy with me that I'm not promoting mm-hmm. things live, you know, that I should. But yeah, at least I'll try to get some videos out there, you know, this next time. And really, I'll do as much as I can to promote stuff. But I'd love to tour. I don't know how that's going to come together. Right.
Yeah, I can see you doing kind of a David Fishoff type of a thing, you know, what putting like you being the conductor and getting all these legendary artists together.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Yeah. Like the Ringo All-Star Tour or the Happy right. Together Tour or something like that. Right. I could see you doing that. Right. You know,
that'd be cool. We actually are kind of talking about that right now. But
okay.
So we'll see how that pans out.
Good.
Maybe on one of the cruises or something.
Right.
We'll see how it goes.
Good. That'll be great. You don't have to do a worldwide tour. You can just do, you know, 10 dates or something like that.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Yeah. Get Annie to come along and maybe Billy Sherwood. Who knows?
Yeah.
You know, Steve Hackett.
Yeah. There you go. Justin Hayward. Alan Parsons.
Yeah. Why not? I think it'd be awesome. What was the first concert you ever went to?
Elton John at Dodger Stadium.
Dodger Stadium. Wow. What year was that?
It was 1975.
75. Wow.
And I snuck my Super 8 camera into the venue and I filmed it. Now, you have to remember, Super 8 cameras at that time didn't have any sound.
Yep.
So all my friends were telling me, "What are you doing? Why are you filming a concert without the ability to record the sound? That doesn't make any sense." But I did it anyway. And I filmed this show, and I stuck the film. And I showed it to a few friends when I got it back, mm-hmm. you know. And it showed Elton going. I mean, it was insane. 55,000 people, and Elton is dancing on top of the piano and picking up the piano bench, throwing it into the audience. I mean, just doing insane mm-hmm. stuff. And I got all of that on film, and showed it to my friends. I thought, well, this is great. And I stuck it in the garage for 4 years. And then I happened to be at the Oscars one day, and I ran into David Furnish,
mm-hmm.
John's husband.
Right.
And, I told him I had this footage that was shot, you know, when I was a kid back at the original Dodger Stadium. And he goes, "You have footage of that?" Well, yeah, it's just kind of, you know. And I thought that would be the end of the conversation. I get a call the next day from the head of Rocket Records in England saying, "We understand you have footage from the Elton John concert back in 1975. I go, "Yeah, well, we'd like to see it." So we went to West Hollywood and met with the head of Rocket Records, a guy named Luke, and showed him the footage, and he was just blown away by it.
Yeah.
Because here's this incredible concert of epic proportions. Elton John's at the peak of his career. Mm-hmm. Nobody had played Dodger Stadium since the Beatles, and they didn't film it. They had a BBC film crew filming stuff backstage, but they didn't actually get the concert. And I had it. So anyway, I gave them the footage, and they ended up using it in the new Disney Plus concert video that he did called Farewell, you know, mm-hmm. Live at Dodger Stadium Farewell thing. And if you watch that program, you can see mm-hmm. all my vintage 1975 Super 8 footage.
It's amazing that you still had it after all these years and in good condition too.
It's good,
yeah. You know, it's amazing. People don't realize there's a lot of great legendary music, and they have no footage at all, you know.
Right.
You know, and every once in a while something will pop up, like there's a new Pink Floyd footage somebody took in 1975. Yeah. And I went to that concert. I went to that tour. Right. And it, you know, it's not great, but still, it's Pink Floyd 1975, you know, but there isn't a lot of footage out there of a lot of great bands. And you, like you said, you wonder why. How come nobody was taking, you know?
Yeah. It didn't make any sense.
No.
Nowadays, that would never happen. Of course, you're going to film that.
Yeah.
You know, with probably 50 cameras, you know.
Exactly. Well, I've got behind me, I've got a bunch of these. I don't know. See that thing in the background? That's over 500 interviews that I've done for 11 or 12 years now. So that's my archives.
Right.
It's all on disc. So if anybody needs any archives of interviews, and a lot of these guys have passed away. You know, I got most of the guys from ELP. I've got Johnny Winter, Tony Joe White, you know, I mean, so that's my name back there.
You've done some amazing interviews over the years. I mean, there's just, you've got,
I appreciate all that. Yeah.
I mean, you're really good at what you do. So I advise you to keep going, you know.
That's because you love it. Just like you. Yeah. If you love doing what you're doing, man, you're going to be good at it no matter what.
Yeah. You know, you can't help it. Exactly.
Here's your final question. And I ask everybody this question. I get some really interesting answers.
Okay.
If you had a Field of Dreams wish, like the movie, and that's my favorite movie of all time, Field of Dreams, to perform or collaborate with anyone from the past or present, who would that be?
Oh, wow. You know, I think I have a tendency to kind of think in realistic terms, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't want to. So, I mean, I could say like Paul McCartney.
Everybody says Paul McCartney. I get that.
I don't know.
So
I, don't know if that's gonna, I don't know if that's going to, but I'm not going to say that. Okay. Yeah. I'm going to be realistic here. I think, you know, I mean, look, I've collaborated with all of my heroes,
right?
You know, Jesse Hayward, Alan Parsons, Steve Packett, Annie Haslam, you know, and Andy Latimer. I mean, I can't think of, I mean, maybe I think the one I'm going to tell you is probably John Anderson from Yes. I think
that's very doable. Yeah.
Which is doable. And the reason I'd say that is because I can probably do that. And that would be someone that I, you know, would, you know, I've admired. Mm-hmm. And collaborate with. Yeah. So
I'm friends with Michael Franklin, who's a producer, and he's producing 1000 Hands 2 with John Anderson, which is coming out at the end of this year. I should hook you up with Michael Franklin, because he does a lot of, you know, he's also a record producer, and he put out a lot of prog stuff as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So you guys should meet. You guys would have a lot in common. He's in Orlando. He's got a studio in Orlando. And he goes way back. He was really good friends with Wolfman Jack. He knows Cat Stevens. He's worked with Cat Stevens recently on a lot of new projects and stuff.
Right.
So he's also an inventor. He invented the battery for the cell phone. I think he invented the wireless battery or something like that. But he goes to China a lot. You know? He's always back and forth to China. He's a good guy. He's a really good guy.
Okay.
So you guys should definitely get together. Maybe you can hook you up with John, you know.
That'd be fantastic. Yeah.
And I know John's PR guy, which is Billy James. I don't know if you know from Glass Onion PR. He's been John Anderson's PR guy for many moons.
Okay. So,
he's a good guy. I've interviewed John many times, and he's such a nice man. He really is.
Well, you've heard my music.
Yes.
Is there anybody you recommend that I collaborate with? That you thought?
Oh yeah, I've got a bunch of them. Sure.
I'll
email them to you.
Okay.
I'll email them to you, and you know, I got contacts where I could. I've actually hooked people together. I put, as a matter of fact, I put John McLaughlin together with Michael. I think he's going to play on one of the albums. I did. I put together Sheree Curry from the Runaways with Suzy Quatro. They didn't. I don't think they ever met before, and I put them together because I know Suzy.
Oh yeah.
You know. So yeah, I'm good at that kind of stuff. Okay. I'm the middleman.
All right.
Because it's funny, you know, a lot of people, you would think, oh, this guy knows this guy. This guy's, you know, sometimes they don't see each other. Even band members don't see each other for years, you know?
Right, yeah, that's true. In this day and age of the internet where you just send files back and forth. You don't
exactly
even record in the same studio anymore.
Yeah, and then I interview somebody. I says, I just talked to your ex-bandmate. Oh, how's he doing, you know? give him my regards, you know? It's so funny. I've been trying lately with no avail to put Heart back together again. You know, let them do the reunion tour for the 50th anniversary.
Oh yeah.
So I know Roger Fisher and Michael. Right. You know, and
I know.
And Steve Fawson, but I just hit a snag with I think it's Howard Lees probably. He doesn't like to do interviews, but I'm trying to get just the guys. And then I was going to work on the girls because I did Anne recently.
We
did a Zoom interview and I know her PR people and everything. So I said, come on guys, for the 50th anniversary, you got to do maybe a short tour or something. Right. And I also tried to do the same thing with, Grand Funk. I had Mark on the show recently.
Yeah.
And I reached out to Grand Funk's management and everything, and he's basically, he's I'm out of it. It's up to those guys.
Yeah.
You know? So I tried.
Yeah, I mean, you would think with so much fan interest in some of these
shows,
if you could just put a few things off to the side just for a couple of months.
Exactly.
You know, you'd make a truckload of money and make everybody happy.
Yes. You know? They owe it to the fans, you know. Yeah. We bought
and they'd make a pretty sum on the side as well.
Yes, they would.
Why not do it? Yeah.
I mean, Grand Funk sold out Shea Stadium faster than the Beatles. You know what I mean? So imagine those guys getting back together again. You know, I mean, it's not going to have the same impact, but still, they're going to have a great following, especially Heart. When Heart was at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, they got together they did one song together. I mean, it was magical. I mean, I almost shed a tear. It was that emotional to see those guys back together again. But I don't know. So much politics involved and grudges and that kind of thing. I don't know. All right. Do we cover everything? What's next? You're working on two albums. Yeah. They're actually remixes.
Okay. Yeah, we're doing More Random Dreams, The Best of David Minasian, Volume 2.
Okay.
And then we've got a new album after that, which will probably be next spring.
Okay. So, is that a remix or are you going to do
No, that's brand new. That's brand all new stuff.
New songs.
Yeah. All new stuff,
Okay. Do you have anybody famous on that album? Not yet. Okay. I will suggest some people for you.
Okay. All right.
And there's some guys.
I don't know how this got started. I mean, the first one had Andy Latimer, which was great. You know, and I thought that was like a one-off thing. And then the second one had Justin Hayward, Steve Hackett, Annie Haslam, Billy Sherwood, and PJ Olson from the Alan Parsons Band all on it, which is like kind of an overload of guest stars. And so that, I guess that's becoming my thing, is to just bring all these people together.
Maybe. Sure.
I don't know.
Why not?
I love it.
Yeah. Billy Sherwood does that too. He even brought in William Shatner.
Yeah, right. I know.
You want William Shatner on your next album?
I don't know.
He's a big prog guy, you know?
Yeah, I know he is. I know.
Yeah.
I don't think he can play anything though. He just talks, right?
Yeah, he talks. Yeah. He's good. Well, I'm going to give you a list of people. I'm going to give you some guys that are just sitting around doing nothing right now that are looking to do stuff. So,
yeah.
And then you can decide who you want to, you know, contact and get excited about, I guess.
All right. Sounds like a plan.
I just want to say you can purchase Random Dreams, The Very Best of David Minasian. Volume one that you can go right to your shop, I guess, which is www.davidminasian.com/shop or your website. And also, I want to mention From the New World by Alan Parsons. That's a great album. I gave it 5 stars. I told Alan that. Loved it. Always loved Alan's stuff, man. He's a legend. He really is.
Yeah.
And also, you know, I love this. This should get more press as well as One Note Symphony. I mean, is that available like on Netflix or anything?
There's a Blu-ray out on it, right, which has the great you know, surround mix. That was we shot that in Tel Aviv.
Yeah.
In Tel Aviv with an 80-piece orchestra and the Alan Parsons band. Just a magical night.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to hear, and they were able to do some songs that they normally don't do, like Silence and I, some of the epic orchestral-based Alan Parsons project tracks on that video. So that one, you want to pick up the Blu-ray on that, Amazon or wherever, or Alan's website. And then the one before that, which was the Neverending Show Live in the Netherlands, is another one, but without an orchestra.
Right.
So that one's great as well.
Did you want that video to be available on Netflix so you can actually watch it, or?
We might. My partner Trinity Houston and I may have some meetings and try to get some of the stuff out there. We've got other ones with Justin Hayward. We did the Spirits Live and Live at the Capitol Theater with Justin Hayward. So those are available too.
was that the Capitol in Clearwater?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, I saw that. You know, I'm only about 45 minutes from Clearwater, south.
Well, you might have been at the show that we did. I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah. that's great. That's awesome. Yeah, that's a good little theater. The acoustics are pretty good, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we have Ruth Eckerd Hall, and Sarasota's got the Van Weasel, and they're building a new venue there. And there's a new venue coming into Clearwater that's an outdoor kind of amphitheater.
Oh, good.
Called The Sound. And that's going to be, I think it's going to be open pretty soon, like next month or something like that. So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I come to Florida a bit, you know, often. So maybe we'll catch up or something.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll make the rounds because Patrick lives in Florida. And I was supposed to go visit Patrick with, we were supposed to go.
Morass?
Yeah, Patrick Moraz lives here.
Oh, okay. In Florida. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was in Clearwater. I think he's somewhere else now. I'm not sure. But Michael Franklin we were supposed to all go together. And then Michael's got a studio in Orlando. So next time you're in Florida, I'll set something up. You know, maybe we can see Patrick. We can go see Michael. You know,
well,
that
Patrick
kind of
and I know each other.
Good.
I met Patrick in mid 80s.
Right.
He was with the Moody Blues, and so yeah, great guy.
You know, my favorite Yes album is Relayer, and it was all
amazing keyboards.
Yeah, he was fantastic.
Yeah,
David, thank you so much, man, for being on the show today. It's been a real pleasure. You are truly a Renaissance man. I admire everything you do. Keep in touch, and I'm going to send you an email. I'll send you the email with all the published links to this interview, which is going to be everywhere. You know, I'm with Spotify, I'm with Pandora, every all the streaming sites, and I'm also going to send you. I'm going to send you. This is my first book. It's about growing up in the family business.
Oh, right.
I'm going to send you a link so you can download the book for free. And the Rockstar Chronicles. This is series 1. This has got over 45 interviews. It's really cool because it's got Keith Emerson in it and Greg Lake and Johnny Winter. I'll send you that too as well.
Yeah, so got a lot. I haven't read that, but I've noticed you have a lot of very cool people in that book. A lot of legends. Yeah.
Very cool. Took me a while to do. The pain in the ass thing is getting the pictures approved, you know?
Yeah.
Getting all that stuff through channels. But you got to have pictures,
right?
You know, David. Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Appreciate
you. My best to you and your family. Say hello to your son for me. Tell
Justin.
Him.
Okay.
Tell him he's an amazing player because he really is.
All right. I will do that.
All right, man.
That's fantastic. All right. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Bye-bye.